Hey, hey, it's Shop Talk, baby. This is the show where it's okay to be you. We're talking from Yale to jail and from the church house to the pip house. Nothing's excluded on Shop Talk. So if you don't have a phone, I suggest you borrow one. Call in and voice your opinion live every Saturday morning from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Yeah, that's right, 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Don't forget to Shop Talk with your girl, because right here, oh, we keeps it real.
That's the bangs. I don't care. I don't care. I do not care. Come on, Ari Lennox. Apply the pressure, baby. Good morning, good morning, good morning to my lovely people. And welcome to Shop Talk with Mel. Let's give it up for our guest who, for some unknown reason, you there? You gonna unmute it?
Good morning, everyone. Happy Saturday. How y'all doing today?
Hey, I thought you muted us.
I did, but I kept doing it. I was playing on the phone up in this month. Let's give it up to Nick the Voice.
Good morning.
All right. Now let's give a round of applause for Nick the Agitator.
Thank you, people. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You're too kind.
Too kind. Too kind. Always kind. All right, listen up. It has been a day. Today's show is going to be in memory of a good friend of mine, Dallas David, who has passed away suddenly. And I can hear her. She got an accent. She was from New York. And I met her 6 years ago. And I'm telling you, you would have never known. And I used to ask her, she's like, Mel, you crazy. I was asking her, what happened to, what's her name? Oh, what happened to the chick off of the Family Matters? I used to ask that. I'd be like, Dallas, what happened to the girl off the Family Matters? She went upstairs, her little sister, and never came back down. Well, let me say that I called her. You know, we text back and forth. We both nurses, RNs, let me be clear. And we'll get back with each other, you know, when we get a chance. So I text her, and then I get a call back. So I'm like, hey, what's up, girl? And her daughter said, I got to tell you about Dallas. And I was like, okay. It was weird. And she told me she passed away. Mm. Now, here's the thing. She said she was making dinner, plated the dinner, and went upstairs. So, you know, I went back to that whole Family Matters thing. Like,
oh, wow.
I was like, and I could hear her when I said it, I could hear her saying, Mel, you crazy. Like, but, and that was it, laid in the bed, and that was it. So we don't know our time, or we just don't know. But, so today's show, we're going to have a great time, is for, in memory of Dallas David. That's my girl. Young. So we don't know. But let me put this out here for the people that, you know, the clickbait to cut happen real, real quick, because I need to get this information out. Listen. Secondhand story. True story, but secondhand. Okay, let me put that out there. Public place, there was a guy, so we know it's out here. There was a guy that sprayed a substance in the air. the girl was by herself. You know, it was a lot of people there, but she was, you know, traveling alone. Sprayed a substance in the air. Well, they all walked through it. Well, it didn't affect her until she said probably like 10 to 15 seconds later, she felt dizzy. She was going to different people and asking them to help her. She was like, no, this guy sprayed this, blah, 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 blah. She went to the workers at this public place. Nobody would help her. And finally, it was a lady that was talking on the bench. It was a younger lady. She said probably like 30 years old. And she said, well, just sit with me. So the reason I'm saying that is like, if you know, you have a lot of us who are out there traveling on our own, doing our own thing, and people are watching and you don't know that they're watching, and you don't know if he was going to come back, because ironically, he did come where she was at. And the girl was giving her water, telling her, drink this water, drink this water. The thing is, he sprayed it in the whole air. Some people had masks, and she was thinking it maybe affected her because she didn't have a mask on. So I just wanted to put that out there, the end result. She's still alive, you know, because somebody took the time to say, okay, wait, I'm not going to leave you, versus everybody minding their own business, which is why today's topic is see something, say something in 2024, because everybody is minding their own business that you just don't know. So I just wanted to put that out there, and I had to do it at the top of the show because, you know, the click of like, hey, what they talking about? Let's get this out here. Safety first. That's your girl at all times. Go! Let's get with this P. Diddy video!
I ain't seen it.
Don't even. I'm not going to play it, though. I can't play it because of how it is.
Can you send me the link on the personal?
Okay. Thank you. Go ahead, Nick. For people who didn't see it, I'm glad you said that. Let me put that out there. It shows where P. Diddy runs out of the room with a towel on. The girl leaves, and he runs out the room with a towel on, and she leaves with these bags or whatever it is. He runs out down the hall after her, after she got a head start. She's waiting on the elevator, and then he comes, boom, throw her, grab these bags. So whatever was in them bags, that's just my thoughts, was important. And he kicks her, tosses her, drags her. He does all of that. And it's sad.
It's very sad. Like
it's sad. But let me do this first and then I'm gonna let you go ahead. Had that been a man, I wonder if it still would be sad. I'm just putting it I'm just putting it out there. Looking at it, not justifying his actions at all. That's not what I'm doing. But what I'm saying is, from what I saw looking at the video, you see her walking down the hall with two things. Probably about 3 to 5 seconds later, he comes out with a towel. She's fully clothed with a hoodie and everything. And he's running down the hall. And the first thing he grabs when he gets to the elevator are those two things. Then he goes back and kick her and drag her and all that other stuff. So my question is, what was in those two bags? I know y'all gonna give it to me. Let me get this number out real quick so y'all could go ahead and see what's happening. That's why he settled real fast, too. Here's the number for my lovely people. So y'all can go ahead and give it to me. I'm here for it. And I'm not justifying it. I don't want to say that. Noelle said she sent it to you this morning. Okay, Cornell said the video is disgusting. It really is. That's why I won't show it. I can't show it. Go ahead, Nick. What you got?
Yeah, because I didn't know what everybody was talking about. It's bad. Whatever, everything that she came out and said is true, and that video is the testament
of what she said. To it.
I guess he must have been asleep. He was drunk, high, so whatever. Intoxicated and was asleep, so she tried to make her break for it. And when he realized that she wasn't in that room, he come flying out with that towel. He was trying to drag her the bags and hold the towel and everything else. And so, yeah, but she better than me, honey, because, yeah.
Well, you don't know when you're in that place.
She wasn't even looking, though, because I think she probably would have at least tried to fight back if she was looking. She wasn't even looking.
She didn't look in the camera because she was like incognito. She was incognito, though. Yeah. She had her hood and stuff on. You could clearly see that was routine behavior.
Yeah.
I'm going to be safe in saying that because of her response.
Stomped her out.
That right there.
Oh, God.
You know what? That right there was really crazy to me. I was like, and the way he kicked her, and then he kicked her the first time. You can't say, okay, well, he was upset. He kicked her again. He drug her.
He drug her.
Now, you know, you can't see any audio on it, so I'm clear she probably just took it as, you know, the same old, same old. But that was horrible. It's horrible, and you don't know what you would do in that situation, especially when people, once they put fear in you. It's up to you to be like, I'm going to take my chances like Tina did, Ike. You know, like, okay, in that limousine, get it. Oh, it's going to be a fight up in here. But you don't know. And when I said that's why he settled so fast on that civil case.
Didn't want that tape out. Guess what? And y'all already know, he go down, he taking a lot of people with him.
Well, you know what? That's probably all those tapes and stuff. That's probably why they rated it like, okay, they already knew he was going to go down. It was like, hold on, wait a second. Let's go in here and get these tapes, confiscate all this footage that he may have. I was wondering, is this some tapes in the bag that she had?
There's no telling.
Because allegedly they were saying he was beating up Kim Porter.
Mm-hmm.
So you had that, and then Kim had told her something, and she's the one. Because all the people, look at Heavy D. Remember Heavy D? Oh, missing. Well, not missing, but passed away. It was just so many on his lineup that actually passed away. And then you had, well, I'll be sure they didn't know what happened with him. Allegedly, with Jamie Foxx, he tried to get with his daughter or something. And then Jamie Foxx had a, air quotes for the listening audience, a mystery disease that they cured. I'm like, what was this mystery disease? Now, I did see on the news, I don't know if I was watching NBC or CBS, where they were saying that particular hotel that P. Diddy paid them $50,000, but I want to put this information out there. The hotel owner, they no longer own, the people who owned it 10 years prior or whatever, no longer owns it. And that hotel owner said that they never received money from him. Now, here's the thing, because, you know, that hotel will go down. Why would I admit that? Why? Like, why I'm going to say that? Then they're going to be like, okay, you hiding footage? Like, no. So I like that one. Noel said, make it out alive. That's it in a nutshell. So take the beatings and make it out alive. Like I said, you guys, you could go, if you haven't seen it, go check it out real quick and then come on back to the show. But me personally, I can't show it. I'm not comfortable showing it myself because it was bad. Did you get to check it out, Nate?
No, I a lot of reading. They're not showing me the
video. No, it's not reading. Okay, I'll get it to you. But I think she got him, and he left her alone and her husband, her new husband.
Good.
So gotta look at that. It's a lot. It is a lot going on.
That kind of make you wonder. You know, when Suge Knight took that jab at him at the awards. Like, now thinking back on a lot of stuff, just like everybody still talk about that Orlando Brown ain't crazy. That boy acted crazy to stay alive.
That's what I think.
I agree.
He's acting crazy to stay alive.
I agree.
Because y'all think I'm nuts, so here we go. Isn't it interesting how they go to their crazy when something happened in Hollywood or they don't agree with Hollywood? Air quotes for the listening audience. Because look at what they did with Dave Chappelle. Remember, they said he was crazy. Remember Martin Lawrence? They said he was crazy on the bridge. If you don't agree with it, it's like, okay, wait, it's a problem. Who else was it? You had Dave Chappelle, Martin Lawrence, Cat Williams, Orlando Brown.
The girl that sing high, 8 octaves, Mariah Carey.
They said Mariah was crazy.
She was stripping on TRL. She just standing there, remember? On the thing and just started taking her clothes off on a teen show.
Oh, wow.
I missed that one.
Right? Like a week after she married the head dude or something like that.
Oh.
Well, I got a question. Catch the video Club Shay Shay, that interview with him and the comedian Kale?
Oh, Kale. I checked it out. I checked it out, and...
Well, I got a personal story about the wife.
Well, okay, because I listened to the story of the wife. I listened to her first when she was talking about it and who she caught him in bed with and all this alleged stuff, but it was able to show his side of the situation.
Baby, I'm going to tell you right now, personal experience. I'm just put it out here. If I ever see her again, girl, don't ever lie on me.
Oh, girl, I thought you were talking about the situation. We got this show. Okay.
Well, no, I'm like, just attesting to his story. She's a trip. When I was living in Georgia, she was there visiting. She was actually in our apartment. She was visiting my brother's friend.
Okay.
A high school boyfriend that she was messing with. So a few of them babies that he was talking about,
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah.
So we're going to go. I got to cover me. Alleged. Okay. So what did you talk about? So I guess his story.
That part, alleged.
Okay. So his story regarding the situation of why he left, there was some accuracy to it from your view.
Hey, let's be quiet now. All the fellas, because I'm staying with my brother.
Okay. Wait. No. I can't do that. Did you see it, Nate?
Yeah.
Okay. Got to protect me and my brain. And I can't do that. Yeah. Okay, I'm looking over here at the comments. Okay, so Noelle said, Diddy got all those dead bodies. She acted accordingly, just took the beating. Were you able to check it out?
Yeah, I seen it.
Okay.
I think it was money in the case, in those bags. It looked like bags of money to me. But, hey, I don't...
Ain't no telling. I wonder if Biggie would have been caught up in all that mess had he still been alive.
Okay, so with that being said, he's gone.
Right.
You know, all these people are gone, and they're looking like, hey, here you go. And everybody's looking at Suge Knight as the monster when that video shows,
that video is domestic. It's bad. But, I mean, I'm not going to put what he do in his house on everybody else. You know what I mean? On everything he does. But, you know, a lot of people end up dying just affiliated or around you. Everybody from Uptown is gone, except Al B.
And he almost was, remember?
But he was coming out with, like you listen to y'all, they call, what's her name, crazy? What's the girl telling all the story with the short fro?
The background singer, Jaguar.
Yeah, Jaguar, right.
But she got receipts, and she making sense.
Listen, and it's coming out.
Yeah.
I was like, okay.
They calling her crackheads and everything else. It don't matter. She's still telling the truth.
Crackhead can see this whole thing. I seen it. Yeah.
It's a whole lot going on. So today's show is See Something, Say Something in 2024. Let's get this show started. Good morning. Listen, today's guest is an author. I've known him for a minute here. And I want to introduce you guys to the author, Shimmie Miller. And the book is called The Ready Rock Boy. The Ready Rock Boy. So, good morning. Let's give it up.
What's going on?
Oh, man, everything. Listen, Shimmie, you decided to write a book.
I did, right?
You did. Do me a favor. Move your camera over because my logo is covering your face. Or slide your body over. How about that? Just slide your body over. There we go. All right. You decided to write a book on your interesting life.
Yeah. I figure if I don't tell my story, somebody else will eventually. So,
child, you ain't lying. They have it all crazy.
That part. That part. For real.
So yeah.
How you doing this morning?
I'm doing good. I'm doing good. It's a whole lot going on. You already know.
Facts.
You already know. Now, facts. I was able to get a little bit of information from the book. The book I want to put out there is pre-ordered. So you guys can pre-order the book. I want to talk about, let's talk about when you moved away.
Okay.
And then came back to your hometown for, let me lay this out here for the people. All right, lovely people. Let me bring it back. Let me rewind it. Okay. I got this information that the people don't. All right. So we have the most respected, I have to say that, Shimmie Miller on as a guest today. He has a very interesting life. You did some time. I mean time, baby. No, I'm like that. Let me get the egg ball. You did some time. And you decided to write a book on your life of everything that you have gone through. Now, I've had you on the show prior to a few years back. And I learned some things that I had no idea of.
Right.
And thinking that everybody, remember, I'm thinking everybody had the same lifestyle that I had. Like, here we go. And I've learned that that is very different. Now, being a young man, I don't even want to say young black. Well, you know what? Young black man, late 80s, early 90s, trying to fit in. Is that a good way to say it or explain it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then how one decision, you were gone, doing your thing, got removed from the area that is so taboo, air quotes for the listening audience, and you got a phone call, and this is in the book. Well, I don't want to tell it all because it's good, y'all. You got a phone call and came back, and that decision, with my eight ball, had you locked down for how many years? Like, go ahead, tell the people, explain it. Let us know what's going on. 26
and a half years.
How many?
26 and a half years.
Oh, man.
Yeah. So I was staying in Baltimore, and a real close friend of mine, I was going to school, playing football, had scholarship offers on it, literally on the kitchen table, like. And a friend of mine's got killed back in here. And an ex-girlfriend of mine, someone who I was still dealing with at the time, she had called me. And she initially told me about it. And I didn't want to believe it. So I'm like, man, get off my phone plan. Like,
so you can say it. You can say the name. William Kitchen got killed.
Yeah, so my dude Kitchen, we called him Kitchen. His name was William Kitchen. We called him Kitchen. I got killed, and so a female that I was dealing with had called me and told me about it, and I didn't want to believe it, so I just like dismissed her and got off the phone. And probably about 5-10 minutes later, it was almost right after, my little brother called, and my little brother get to telling me about it, and I'm like, and that's messed up. I'm like, but the way he talking to me about it is he expected me to do something. I'm like, what you want me to do? Like, and just the fact that I believe anyway, he could speak to it more, but I believe that just the fact that I didn't respond the way he had been used to me responding to things made him mad. And he just started calling me all kind of names. Like, you know, I can't believe you just gonna just do nothing and your dude got killed. Cause you know, Kitchen was part of our crew. We all grew up together. Like we was like brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Ran the streets together. And so, you know, my brothers get to going off on him. He get to going off on me. Now this is my baby brother. Like, at the time I had three of them, but this is the one like right under me.
Mm-hmm.
Anything I do, he wanna do.
Okay, so he looked up to you as a role model.
Yeah. And I didn't realize it at the time, like the way I realize it now, but yeah. And so it just didn't sit right in my spirit.
What type of names did he call you though?
We can say
it. You can say it. It's shop talk, baby.
It was just like, man, you old ass nigga. Like, I can't believe, like, you ain't gonna do nothing, man. And they killed your dude. Like, and I'm like, huh? He's like, man, he just kept saying, like, you a hoe. And I'm just like, it's my little brother talking to me. And we wound up getting off the phone. And I'm sitting, I remember sitting in my office living room, because I actually was doing homework when I got the phone call. So I remember sitting in my uncle's living room, and it just wasn't sitting right in my spirit. And my little brother looked at me like that and said those things to me. And so, literally from that moment, I was like, okay, as soon as I graduate from high school, I'm out. I'm going back. And going back and look for this dude. And so I graduated from high school on June 7th. But 2 days after I graduated, I was on a Greyhound bus back to Youngstown. I never wound up seeing the dude.
Mm-hmm.
I ran into him one time. And by the time I recognized and realized who it was, he was gone.
Okay.
I never seen him again after that. But I was back. And I was immediately back with my dudes and doing what we do. And
what was that that y'all did? Come on and talk, baby. This shop talk.
We sold drugs.
Okay, so.
We sold a lot of drugs.
Okay. And, I mean, do you name the book after your club or whatever, the group?
So here's the thing about the book, too, and I want people to realize, right? So one, we actually didn't, a lot of people don't know this, we actually didn't give ourselves that name. Somebody else gave us that name.
Okay, the name is Ready Rock Boy. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so somebody else gave y'all the name. Okay.
Somebody else actually gave us that name. And it's an organization that's doing great work right now, right? The people who are running the organization weren't the people who had started the group back then.
Oh, well, that's good. Okay. But it still would have been good. Like, hey, get back. You look what you come on. Okay. Appreciate it.
But they're doing amazing, amazing work.
Okay.
But the reason I didn't name it Ready Rock Boys and just Ready Rock Boy is because it's my story.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to speak for nobody else.
Mm-hmm.
So everybody else might do their thing. I know my dude Darnell, he already wrote his book. We were supposed to be in talks for a docuseries.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody couldn't get on the same page with that, but you know, you still never know. But I don't want to tell everybody else's story, so I didn't want to put it out there like I was telling our story as a whole. I'm telling my story.
Let me let the people know. Darnell's book is Determined Life.
A poor man's Hollywood.
Now that's what I like. That's what I like.
But he said, but I seen that. I'm like,
oh,
that's nice.
Yeah, a poor man's yeah. Hollywood. So that's what's up. But back to yours with Ready Rock Boy.
Yeah. So I just wanted to tell my story.
And okay.
Really, I initially never even.
So no, let's get back on track. So you were in Baltimore. You graduated high school. Your brother called you a sucker. You was like, I ain't no sucker. I'm about to get on the Greyhound. I'm coming back. Just get this dude, never seen the dude, and you end up back where you started.
Well, end up back where I started. And it was like I never left. You know, it was like I never left. Back again like I never left. And that was I graduated, that was the summer of 92.
Mm-hmm.
By the summer of 93, I was on my way to prison for what was supposed to be the rest of my life.
So you made a decision, graduated, June 7th, got on the Greyhound, got here, and end up getting arrested for the rest of your life.
Uh-huh.
And then you got out, what year? What was that, 3 years ago?
2019.
No,
don't shortchange
me. I ain't gonna shortchange, baby. He's like, I did a whole 26. Give me mine. Oh, yeah, it was before COVID. Okay.
Yeah, I got out just before COVID. I'm talking about maybe like a couple months before COVID really hit like hard. But yeah, yeah, it was a blessing too because they was taking it real bad. They was getting done real bad in prison. My brother almost died from it, and that was not a good place.
So you got out in 2019 to be locked down on the outside.
But I was outside.
But you was outside.
I'd call a girl over. I'd go outside. Yeah, it was locked down. But here's the thing, though. I didn't lock down. People probably would, in hindsight, be like, man, this dude was tripping. But I was outside. Now, I was outside cautiously, but I was outside. Like, you ain't just about to just...
Put you back in the house. Here. You ain't about to sit down.
Mm-hmm. And I had a at the time, I had an older white lady who was my PO. She was so scared of COVID. Like, she wouldn't even come to my house. So, or if she pulled up, she'd just say, stick your head out the door so I can see. That was it. She was on her way to retire. She had about 10 cats. She wasn't, she ain't want no smoke.
Said 10 cats retired. She like, I ain't about to die going over to see somebody. Talking about, you doing all right? Yeah, okay.
Like, I caught her at the grocery store one day buying a few bottles of wine. She just looked like she's sitting in the house with the wine and the cats. And that's her life. And she cool. And she ain't want no part of no COVID, nothing.
I heard that. So tell me. You wrote the book. Why?
I wrote the book because, now here's a little snippet out that's in the book. I initially wrote a poetry book.
Mm-hmm.
I started writing poetry when I was in solitary confinement.
Okay.
The way I was in solitary confinement by myself. I did 10 months in solitary confinement.
Okay.
A lot of people go crazy. You know, I'm in there. I'm not allowed out my cell at all. And that's like, they got a video camera, and they got me shackled and handcuffed, all that stuff. But they barely let me.
A video camera.
Because they felt out that I was really dangerous, and they had to record everything that I did for their protection.
Okay.
So that was it was only if I went to the if I was going to the hospital if I was going to the infirmary, which is the prison hospital, that they would let me out my cell. I wasn't allowed out for nothing else. That start playing on me. And I used to dabble with poetry, you know, we kids like roses red, violets and blue type stuff. But I never really tried to take it serious. But when I was in there by myself, I just started playing with it. And I used to always lay there in the bed and I used to watch the ants. Like, just watch they watch their life, right?
Wait, you talking about the crawling ants, bugs?
Yeah.
Okay.
They was my homies.
Okay.
They were talking.
Oh, don't tell me you was like Michael Jackson with Ben the Mouse.
Listen. Hey, listen. When you're in a small space for almost a year, you know. But my very first poem was about the ants.
Do you remember it?
I can't remember. I'm answering your question. Uh-huh. I can't remember the content of the poem itself, but I remember the last line in the poem was, will my life ever be as bright as these ants? Like, cause they living their life. Like they living their life. And so that was the last line of the poem where I was questioning, would I ever again live my life as free as these ants is? So fast forward, I finally, 10 months later, I get out of solitary confinement, they transfer me.
Mm-hmm.
I actually start writing poetry.
Okay.
It started consuming a lot of my time. So, and I wound up writing a poetry book that I actually tried to get published, almost had published. I got some advice from a couple older brothers who had published some stuff, and they told me that they were basically trying to buy my rights and just have their way with my stuff. So mm-hmm. I didn't go that route. But I always held on to it. Fast forward another probably 10 years. Still writing here and there. I actually accumulated probably like over 300 poems. And so I'm in now I'm the staff barber at one of the institutions that I'm in. And I would always write while I'm sitting in the barbershop. And I keep my stuff right in the barbershop. Where it was a sergeant who didn't like me. Just felt like I had way too much influence with the homies and the staff.
Okay.
And one day, he just literally went in the barbershop and took my stuff and just destroyed it. And I ain't going to get too much because it's in the book, but that was a crucial point, right? And then I remember I had a really great relationship with the major at the time. And he told me, he said, man, if you wrote it once, you could write it again. But I never could get back in that space. It did something to me, and I never could get back in that space. So as a result of not being able to write poetry, I just started writing about my life. And that's how it started. So I just would write about my life. Just everything that I could remember, I just wrote. And then I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna put a book together. So I would write, and then when I came home, you know, life started life, and I'm trying to get on track, trying to do so. It kind of got.
Tell me this without telling too much. I don't know if it's in the book, but when you were writing those over 300 poems, and an employee in the prison system ripped it up. At this time, you had no idea that you would be getting released. Well, I'm glad your response was what it was.
I'm glad I had people around me.
You was like, let me be clear, okay.
I'm glad I had people around me, yeah, because I didn't know if I would ever get out. I mean, you know, it had started looking better, but I still was serving life. I still had just got 5 more years at the parole board. But it was people around me who didn't allow me to go down that rabbit hole, because I was going to go down that rabbit hole. It was only a couple moments after I changed my life around, because before then it was all penitentiary. Whatever going on in penitentiary, pretty much drugs, whatever.
You just knew you were there, so you was like, this is my life.
Right. Once I changed my life around, and my mindset changed, it started bringing people, different people to me.
Okay.
But that was the only time that I was about to risk any chance of freedom that I had, because I was going down that rabbit hole.
Okay. Well, he overstepped the boundary. Sound like it was intentional.
It was. It was very intentional. And it was like, somebody taking your baby from you. That's how I felt. It was like somebody he just took my baby from me and just said, I don't care nothing about it. It don't mean nothing to me. So I'm going to just discard your baby. And that just was, it was like all my thoughts. You told me not my thoughts wasn't important. Anything that I wrote, anything that I felt, you said wasn't important. That's how I looked at that. And
that's pretty much it. And you do have people in place to agitate people.
Yeah.
To definitely agitate people. It's like, okay, here we go. But I think that was a lot of nerve of that individual to do that, knowing that you got life, so you don't have nothing to lose. And I'm saying that from me working in there. I've worked in there, 20 years? And it's like the difference, and I try to tell people and explain to them, I said, the difference is I'm able to go home, but I'm locked in there. I felt like I was locked in there, so I can't imagine you guys. Because I used to be like, okay, wait, my whole life depends on who works in central control. And where you are, like, it's nuts.
Yeah. And that's why I say, had I been who I used to be,
mm-hmm.
I wouldn't be here right now. I promise you that.
So let's fast forward. Let's fast forward without giving away the book. When you went up for parole and they said, okay, what was that feeling?
I remember sitting on the phone. I was on the phone because my sisters and my niece had went to the parole board hearing. So the people had already warned me about the process, about how long it was going to take before I knew something. Now, mind you, I'm waiting 9 months before. For a decision, that was in and of itself scary and an experience, because when people find out that you waiting on a parole board decision, you have people who ain't never said nothing, made sure they stayed out your way. All of a sudden, they tough, and because they know you got something.
Okay.
Right. So just that in and of itself was navigating the minefield. But I remember sitting on the phone. And everybody in the dorm knew I was waiting on my decision.
Mm-hmm.
And my sister Trina picked up the phone, and she said, "Bruh, And it wasn't, and I don't know if she did this on purpose, and I never thought to ask her, but it wasn't like she had a lot of excitement in her voice, right? It wasn't, it was just kind of like even keeled. So I couldn't read a lot, but when she said, she was like, bro, you coming home in June.
And she said it called like that?
Yeah. So I'm like, so I'm thinking, now mind you, the guys who went before me, they got an out date, we call it out date, mm-hmm. but it was always a year away. Mm-hmm. So they go and they say, well, if it was June 20, 2020, they say you going home June 2021,
right? Okay.
Which was still great because you knew you was going home.
Uh-huh.
So everybody had been doing that, but been getting that. So when she said, you come home in June, I'm like,
you talking the same year?
I'm like, man, I only got a year left. She like, no, you coming home in June in 2 months. I dropped the phone. I literally dropped the phone. I was sitting on the last phone, the first phone, and I dropped the phone. And one of my dudes, he had kept walking by because he's trying to gauge me, and he's trying to see what's going on. And I dropped the phone. And when I picked the phone back up, I said, I'm coming home when? She said, you coming home in 2 months, bro. Wow. And literally, tears started rolling out of my eyes. And my dude walked by, and all I could do is like this. That's a funny story behind that. But all I could do is like this. And he disappeared, right? And I'm sitting there. I'm just, I can't explain to you. I had so many emotions, but I'm listening to her tell me about the healing and tell me about what was said about me, and good and bad. And I'm just like, I'm going home in 2 months. Like, this shit is over.
That is amazing. So let me ask you this. Knowing you were going home, breaking up a little bit. You with me? There you go. Knowing that you're going home in 2 months, how careful were you?
Listen, I almost didn't want to get off my bunk, right? I almost didn't want to get off my bunk, but I had to go to work, and I was in the work. I had to go. It was two places I went, work and workout. If you caught me in between there and did something to me, then, but that was the only, I didn't go to the chow hall. Matter of fact, I started working out in the dorm just so I didn't have to go to the gym all the time. I would get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and try to work out before everybody got started. Some dudes started working out. Some dudes from Cleveland started working out around that time, right? So I'm trying to get my workout on. And so they just come in, they doing their thing. And they kind of just bombard me. They would have never did nothing like this before. Had never done like nothing like this. And the dude literally said, I'm like, damn, man, y'all just gonna act like I ain't here. And the dude literally says out his mouth, man, you ain't gonna do nothing. You trying to go home. He was on his way home. No matter what, he had flights. He was going home in like a couple months. And he literally said to me, man, you ain't about to do nothing. You trying to go home. And I I said, man, you absolutely right. I'm trying to go where you about to go, man. Y'all can have this. And I left and went back to my bunk. Got my shower stuff, got in the shower, and laid on back down. I said, yeah. But it was like trying to navigate a minefield, for real.
Which is like, I'm going to be a sucker in here. I got 2 months, sucker.
What did they say? I'm going to be quiet right now.
But when you leave, I'm going to be talking again.
For real, yeah. So
I'm gonna let the co-host come on in and talk to you. But I got a question for you. Yeah. What is the RICO charge? Can you explain that to me?
A RICO charge, now, a RICO charge is when they take what they consider an organization or a gang, and they attach all of these different charges to them. It could be anywhere from murder, drugs, sex trafficking, money laundering. They attach a whole array of charges or crimes to them to try to enhance the punishment that they're going to get if found convicted of these charges. So where I might get charged with drug trafficking as an individual, I might get 5 years. But if they establish that we are doing this as an organization, I can get 20 years.
So did they charge you? Oh, kind of like what they did with R. Kelly?
That was something totally different.
But so did they charge? Did they try to charge you with the RICO charge?
So what wound up, what ended up happening was when I got, no, they never tried to charge me, but my lawyer told me the reason they didn't charge me is because I had already got life. I got sentenced in December of 93. All the rest of my dudes got locked up in January of 94.
Okay. Right?
So I was already serving life by the time they got incarcerated. So my lawyer literally came and seen me, and he said, the only reason that they're not coming to get you is because they see you already got life in prison.
Wow.
One of my dudes that got caught by the feds that actually got life was Darnell. Everybody else just got, like, I mean, they got time, like 10, 15, 20 years. But to the feds, my time going to be worse than what they get. So they ain't bothered.
But why? Do you know why?
Why what?
Why your time was, like, you was the first one.
Mine was life. They were getting, like, 25. I think the worst was 22 years or something. So no matter what, that person was getting out. They looked at it like I wasn't getting out. I had life. So ain't no sense of messing with him. It ain't that. I mean, we're only getting them for drugs anyway. It ain't like they getting us for murders and all that stuff that I could do this life and then go, if I ever got paroled, then go do life in the feds.
Okay, so the drugs, so the Ready Rock. Mm-hmm. Life for Ready Rock.
Life for Ready Rock.
Because I know it was at a time, I don't know what it is now, I ain't like no drugologist. We know that ain't a word. Where my bail at? But, like, I know it was like 10 years of rock some time ago.
At one point, it was a crack versus powder law.
And right.
Basically something like that. I can't remember the specifics, but if you got 5 years for powder cocaine, you were getting 50 years for crack cocaine.
Okay, so it was 10. Cocaine. Okay, so it was 10. Yeah. Okay, well, I'm going to let the co-host get up here and I'm going to holler at you.
Okay.
Shimmie!
What's up, man? How you,
man? Dude, I'm loving it. I didn't even know you was on. Yeah. Stuff like that. I was like, jeez. I got to learn to read now because I'm interested, man. I got to get the book.
Hey, it's a nice read, man.
I just finished saying I am, so I'm ready. But yo, fam, I had a small vacation, and I know, you know, some of the things you're talking about and what you've seen and what you've done. I want to know, personally, what changed, what was the point that made you change while you were in?
When I was doing that time in solitary confinement, I went to solitary confinement for a gang fight. It wasn't even my beef. I got to the institution. I literally was on at the institution for 30 days. I met a couple good brothers, wound up in some stuff, and because we rock with the same, we always bloods. It's like this is what it is.
Yeah.
When I went to solitary confinement. And I was in this, and I was in the cell by myself.
Yeah, that's.
I just looked in the mirror, man, and you could know this, you know, the solitary confinement. Them mirrors is like, I always tell people, the mirrors are like the fun mirrors at the carnival bar. You never get an accurate perception of what you're looking like, right?
And they'll tell you the story about yourself,
man. Ooh. And I looked in the mirror, and I'm just like, man, like God, I literally said this. God, you know my heart, man. This ain't who I am. That's literally what I said. And immediately, wow. he started sending people, man, to me to help me. You know what
that's
I'm saying?
Testimony. That's a beautiful testimony. Yeah. I know that you can only tell what time of day it is because of what's on the plate or the neutral loaf. I don't know. You don't even know what time of day it is. Oh,
People don't get it, man. Yeah.
In months?
It's a different type of bit. It's a different type of bit.
Yeah.
I didn't even think about that. So yeah, you was able to tell what time of day it was from...
on the plate.
Yeah.
Until you see what's on the plate.
Wow.
The shift change.
Oh.
Yeah, okay, man. But that's it.
That's
and
it.
You and them with your box. And did they let you have a pencil or what were
you? Yeah, I had all type of magazines and writing stuff like that. I was able to order. You know what I'm saying? So you know, you try to use that to barter with, you know, all that.
Yeah.
So that though, but yeah, that's how I actually started writing. But that was it. I ain't had nothing else.
Wow.
Man, you know what? I gotta share something real quick, which is interesting. So I'm at work. It's Lent. And in the infirmary, like you talked about, so we in medical. Dude was in solitary confinement, sick, so he in the back. I'm working back to back the weekend, so I had 2 McDonald's fish sandwiches, right? I had my one. Well, I left it in the refrigerator. I leave it in the refrigerator because I know that I'm coming right back, so at least I have something there. So we had this one guy there. We called him Prince. Because he looked just like Prince's child. He did. But he had pica. Pica is where he would eat like the paint, the metal, all that other stuff. But I knew, I felt like he was in solitary confinement so long that that's what happened. Right. And I was like, I know ain't nothing wrong with you. So he would always do Prince's move. You know what I'm talking about, right? So anyway, I'm talking about my fish sandwich, right? I come in there. I'm like, where's my fish sandwich? Blah, 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 blah. Well, he wasn't acting right. Air quotes for the listening audience. And this one nurse was there. And I'm looking for my fish sandwich. This one nurse didn't say nothing. I walked back by there. And I was like, I know one thing. And I'm going on saying what I'm saying. The dude, he knocks on the door. He was like, Nurse Ross. I was like, yeah. He was like, can I get another one of them fish sandwiches? They gave him my fish sandwich. I was like, what? And by now, so we on 12s. I'd have been there since 6 o'clock talking about this fish sandwich. It's 5 o'clock. And he let me know that the other nurse, Rogerio, gave him my fish sandwich. I was like,
anything.
Right. Anything.
Listen.
I'm gonna take all the risk in the world.
It was a McDonald's fish sandwich too. Okay.
Yeah.
That was so, it was funny. After I looked, I was like, all right. But, like, I'm starving. And this cat didn't have it the whole time. He watching me walk past. He just looking out the little window. And then at 5 o'clock, that's when he let me know. He was like, Nurse Ross.
He might have fought everybody in camp in there trying to get that fish sandwich back, too.
Keep it. Okay, I had my other question. Well, I know, I mean, I'm loving the testimony and stuff like that. And, you know, 10 months, it definitely made you. Because, you know, I've seen you when we was kids coming out around and stuff like that. I didn't know you. But I see what you've done since you've been home. You remember, where was we at? The OG, and I said, hey, dude, listen, I see you.
Yeah.
And I'm proud. I see you with the kids.
I appreciated that too, man.
Hey, man, I see you. And I know, I didn't know what you went through. But I, you know, well, yeah, he's been away, and he come out and he's doing this. That's admirable. You know, to come out and run and continue to run because you can get distracted. But what was the hardest thing to relearn when you got out? Or what freaked you out the most? Like when I came home, seeing cars move, they was like real fast. I was like, whoa. You know, distance and stuff was off. You
know? It was a few things, but one of the biggest things was public spaces. And I literally remember a sister that I was dating at the time taking me out to eat, and they literally sat us in the middle of the restaurant, right? We ordered our food, but all the time I'm steady on a swivel, my head, right. And she looking at me, and she could just tell that I'm uncomfortable. And I'm trying. Man, they got that food there. I ain't even taking a bite of that food. I said, I gotta go. And she said, come on, right? And I left that food right there, man. And that took me a while. Even to this day, though, I still, man, it's probably prison, but it's There's a lot to steal the street. When I go somewhere and I go sit down, I make sure ain't nobody behind me. I can see everything. And people don't really get that, right? That they've been through. I'm always looking at exits and making sure that if somebody is behind me, I know who that is.
Right. Yeah.
Ain't no whole bunch of people behind me.
I have to speak to that. I think it might be prison.
Uh-huh.
And the reason, listen, I'm going to be flat out honest from me. I can only speak for me, and I'm on the employee side. Once I said, yeah, I worked there, it took me some time to get there, okay? But I find myself, even to this day, you can't sit behind me. I'm checking out the exits. I'm looking at everything. And that's where I got high blood pressure, because you're always on edge. I never had high blood pressure until I started working in corrections, and it was like boom, boom, and your mind is constantly clicking, and you have to watch the questions that you answer and how to answer them, and I'm on the other side.
Yes. It's, I'm glad you said that, ma'am. And you just, this is so key, and bro, you can understand this. It's exhausting. Just follow me on this. It's exhausting to, I tell people, I have to think with three minds.
All the time.
I got to think as a black man. I got to think as a man first. Then I got to filter it through being a black man. Then I got to filter it through my prison experience. Because I want to make sure that I'm responding the way normal people respond. And not as a result of me doing 26 years in prison. Right? That's exhausting.
Well, tell me this. Now, I'm sure you see the staff that work in there, and you see the nurses that come through. And when you guys are asked a question, you're actually waiting on like 9 answers off of one question. So am I right or wrong on watching how to answer a question?
Definitely. Absolutely. You better watch how you answer a question. Yeah. You better watch, especially if it's, man, it's, yeah, it's so many that if it's a female, you better watch how you answer it. If it's a white person, you better watch how you answer it. I mean, it's so many things you process in your head in that much time before you answer questions in there. And that just ain't just with staff. That's with anybody, right? Because a decision in there, unless you heavy in the streets, because I always tell people, like, prison almost is just, it's like a microcosm of if you're a street person, right? Because in the streets, you can make a decision that can cost you your life. In prison, the same thing. You can say something that can cost you your life immediately. You can do something that can cost you your life immediately. So it ain't just staff, it's period. Like, a brother brought an interesting proposal to me not too long ago. I ain't gonna give it up because you know, people like to steal people's stuff.
We already know. Go ahead.
It's addressing prison and prison reform and all that stuff in a completely different way that I've never thought about before. And when he brought it to me, I'm like, damn, that's genius. So we're gonna be doing that. But
okay,
you have to all the time.
Now, I heard you say a female you were dating, 26 years. You gotta put me on, Shimmie. You gotta let your girl know what's happening. How do you date in there?
So a funny thing is this. So prior to prison, I was a dope boy. I was a radio rock boy.
Okay.
I had money. I didn't know how to really talk to women. Right? Because I didn't really have to.
Right? Because they just came to you.
You know what I'm saying? In prison, absence the physical and the money and all the trinkets and all that, you actually have to learn how to speak. And so, unless you want to be by yourself, you better become good at it. So, you know, they got all type of date websites and
but
all that.
How do you get that in? Okay, let me say this. Let me rewind a little bit. I had no idea that you were selling drugs back then. I had no idea.
Of course you didn't. Of course you didn't.
Look at you.
Listen, I told you. Male, listen. I told you. You was the pretty boozy chick that stayed way away from where we stayed at. So you, yeah, you wasn't gonna never see the stuff that we see, even when you came around. Like, and that's another thing. Like, you wasn't always around. So, like, if you was around every day, you would have seen some stuff. But you wasn't around every day. So when you come around, like, dudes ain't on that type of time. So for you to tell me that you ain't know some of the stuff you knew, I'm like, yeah, I ain't surprised.
I tell her that all the time, man. She was a pretty bougie bro. She don't want to believe man. It. People act different around you, male.
You act different around you.
You know what woman, a woman shows up, a man straightens up a little bit. Here's and my you were talking about dating. Male don't understand how sweet your that pen get when you locked up. Man, I used to write some letters, Hallmark.
Yeah.
I got nothing but time. Right. Yo, thou was prettiest. Thou right. teeth. Oh, them right. letters. You try some of them letters? Shimmie, tell me. Your letter game was sweet. I man, know listen, you.
I ain't even gonna hold you, man. Woo-hoo. I ain't even gonna hold you.
I gotta go on the outside. Listen,
I had one experience where, so I get on this pen pal site, right?
Uh-huh.
So I put a picture on there, but the picture is a simple picture of sweatpants, tank top, you know. But I'm popping it. I'm popping it. This sister, she lived in Belize, right? So I'm popping it. Boom, boom, boom. So about the fourth letter in, she hit me back. She say, you ain't as thug as I thought you was based off your picture. So I ain't really trying to kick you no more.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Hey, listen. But you got to, man. You ain't, you know what I'm saying? You ain't got no money. You ain't got no cars. You ain't got none of that stuff that attract women.
Right.
Except all you got is your mouth. And if you don't know how to use that.
And that halt, man, them letters, that was fire. Yeah.
Facts.
I had another thing we were talking about. I didn't know too much about what brought you about the prison reform and stuff like that. But it's sad, but I believe that a lot of these young kids, if they go and get in the right situations in prison, it'll teach them a lot about the world. You know, because respect, you will learn respect. You will know what it is.
I tell people, this is sad, but this has become a reality in our culture for a lot of people. Not for all, but for a lot of people. For a lot of young black men, prison has become our man, where we get our manhood training at. In our culture, it used to be when a young lady reached puberty, And a boy start having nocturnal dreams, okay, the elders say, okay, y'all got to go be taught how to be men and women. And they get all the manhood and womanhood training that they're supposed to get in order to help the community, the village. Now it's prison. Because they sent us at such a young age, that's where we get everything from. But even the stuff that we get, like if I'm completely honest, I still have some emotional immaturity because you only mature when you experience things. And in prison, it's hard to experience things. So our maturation stage or progression is a lot slower than if I'd never been in prison. I tell people right now, even I'm about to have a birthday coming up. But I'm still learning lessons that I should have learned in my 20s and early 30s.
I love the transparency. And I'm glad you said that. Because there is some things that you look and you be like, what is he thinking? You don't want to do that. And not looking at the fact that you were removed while we're still moving, going on. We're just going. Where it's like, they should know that. You're absolutely right. You wouldn't. I did talk to a guy when... Nate the Agitator actually asked the question, what was strange for you? What was different from you? There was a young man that went to court. I'll never forget. And he said to me, he was like, yeah, they watching you. He went to court. He said he had to go to the bathroom. They flushed the toilet. And I was like, they don't flush the toilet for you. Had no. And then it clicked. I was like, oh, I was like, no, he was when he came in, you flushed it yourself. Now they automatically flushing it. He thought somebody was watching him the whole time. And, you know, turned the water on for him and everything. And it clicked like, look how long he's been down, you know? So those are the type of things that we take for granted that other people are like, oh, wait, go ahead, Nick. Go ahead. What'd you say? Go ahead, Shimmie.
It's so funny you say that. So, so when you're in a cell with a guy, and you got one toilet, right? And y'all locked down, and you got to go to the bathroom. So you try to put up, the curtain and all that, try to make some privacy. But the one thing that was mandatory, no matter what, is if it dropped, you flush. Right? Courtesy flush is mandatory. So I brought that mentality home. So I'm using the bathroom one day.
How high was that water bill? Go ahead.
So look, I'm using the bathroom one day, and the sister that I'm dealing with, she like, why you keep flushing the toilet like that? I'm like, if it dropped, you flush, right? She like, yeah, when you start paying your own water bill, you're going to stop doing that, right?
I'm worried about that. The question I have is, speaking of when they, brought up and said respect, speaking of respect, sir, I don't know if everybody knows, but for the listening audience, tell them about your organization and how you got started.
I got started in 2011 while I was still incarcerated. I just got 5 years out of the parole board. They said I wasn't suitable for release. That's what they tell everybody till they feel like you did enough time. They said I wasn't suitable for release. And so I'm sitting, I was devastated, crying, snot running out of my nose, all that good stuff. And so couple weeks later, I'm getting myself back together. I'm like, this is where it is. And a brother, at the time, I was a part of the NAACP. And so a brother sat down with me, and he said, and all the homies, so let me back up a little bit. There's certain things that you do that everybody want to be a part of, right, that make you cool in the penitentiary. If you're good at basketball or sports, everybody going to like you, right? If you working out, you big and all that, a lot of people gonna like you. People probably gonna fear you, whatever, but a lot of people gonna gravitate towards you because the perception is when I come to the joint, I gotta get big so don't nobody mess with me, right? Boom. I stayed in the gym. If you didn't catch me in the barbershop working, I stayed working out. All the homies, all the little homies love to come work out with me, right? And so, but I wouldn't say antisocial, but I was so focused on what I was doing that if you didn't catch me working out or walking from the gym to my dorm and you wasn't in my dorm, you ain't really have a lot of conversation with. I ain't really do a lot of hanging out. I ain't have a big circle, none of that. But the homies always gravitated toward me. So what wound up happening is a brother asked me, say, okay, you got this time now, what you gonna do, man? You got these little homies that's looking up to you, that's, around you when they can and boom, boom, boom. And I'm like, I don't know. He said, man, you should think about doing a program. And so he and I literally sat down and started thinking about a respect program. He shortly after got paroled and was gone before we completed. I'm talking about maybe like in a week. He was gone. But we had started, he had lit this thing in my head. And I'm like, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and do it. And I tell people my program ain't, you ain't gonna find it in no college course or nothing like that. But I wanted it simple because I want to be able to relate to the people that I'm talking to, and I want them to be able to understand. And statistics say that most people who are incarcerated don't have a high school education. So you got to be aware of certain things if you're trying to get to people. You got to talk to them in the language that they have and things like that. So I made my program really simple, but it wound up becoming really popular. And the reason it became really popular. There's something Mel alluded to is my transparency, my willingness to be open about my life and everything I went through. So I'm running the program. It's pretty successful. When I came home, so during that time, I started thinking like, man, if I ever get out, like I would love to have this as an organization. Like, this would be dope. And I created the acronym for the word respect and all that. And so fast forward 7 more years.
Wait, we can't fast forward. What's the acronym for respect?
It's reaching everyday solutions positively and encouraging community togetherness. Okay. So, and I felt in prison, respect is huge. That's actually where in prison, I don't care who you talk to, the most important thing to them is respect, right? Respect from everybody else. Because if somebody respects you, they ain't trying to hurt you. It's a lot of things that come with just being respected in prison, right? And so even the young boys, they're causing riot if they feel like they being disrespected. But the problem is a lot of men don't really understand what respect is and what that looks like. You know what I'm saying? And so that's where the whole word and the acronym came from. And so when I came home, I took the program. I did the program a few times, and I just started doing the work to make it an organization. And that was a full-fledged nonprofit.
I see. And yeah, I just wanted to say the growth that I've seen from the time that I met you, we ain't gonna get on that, and the time you came home to now, I just want to tell you, my brother, I am so proud of y'all. This is like my little brother. I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of you. And like, keep reaching. I know sometimes with certain things, you know, you get down and it's like you're frustrated. I just want to keep your head up and keep going, because you're doing it.
I appreciate that.
Well, I ain't going to tell you the first time I met you.
Okay.
You might not know it. Just put it that way. And you scuffed my rim. I had a Chevette with rims, and you messed up my rims. We'll talk about that after the show.
Okay, yeah, that's
Here's another question I got. Can you text?
Can I text?
Yeah. Because, I mean, all this stuff came while you were late.
Listen, so when I started, when I started my transition, right, I ain't just completely go all the way on the right side, right?
Right.
It was some stuff that happened and I needed to make some money. But what I didn't do is sell drugs again. But I sold a lot of tobacco, because tobacco had became illegal. So I sold a lot of tobacco. But before I sold tobacco, I said I would watch how dudes would get caught up. And they always got caught up using the phone. Right? To check on stuff or talk about stuff. I said, before I do anything, I got to get me a phone. So I wound up getting me a phone. And for me, it was just so I could call, hey, did the money get there? X, Y, and Z. I had a homeboy out of Akron. He know I got this phone. So he fresh off the streets. He ain't been off the street maybe a year, 18 months. So he hip to all this stuff. Right. So he thinking I got all these different things on my phone. And I don't. I just got it. He could just tag
call
it. And he like, bro. He like, man, you got to get a camera on your phone. Like, what do I need a camera for? He like, bro, you need a camera. So I go back to the sister that I'm involved with. I'm like, look, I need another phone, right? Uh-huh. She like, all right, boom, boom. So she bring me another phone. So he got this phone. He like, hey, bro. He like, man, you ain't got internet on this phone. I'm like, internet? He like, bro. Need the internet on your phone, bro. Now, in hindsight, he working me, but I don't know no better.
So yeah, you fresh.
So I go back to the sister. I say, hey, I need a phone with the internet. How you give me a phone without no internet? I don't even really know what the internet is, right? But I'm regurgitating what he did tell me. So she like, look, this is the last one. I ain't bringing you no more. I'm like, all right, cool. It's cool. So she bring me the phone. Literally, the email that I have right now today is the email that he put on my he used my phone to set up for me in prison 10 years ago, right? And so I get the phone, I got the internet, I got all this. I barely used the phone. I only had it when I wanted to make a call to check on something. He had the phone, he all on, you know, we in joint, so you got a phone, you got something with some internet access.
You know, only fan.
Yeah, oh, you know what I'm saying? So that's how, but I say that to say, this Joker, man, when I came home, was one of the biggest, even though I had phones, was one of the biggest adjustments. I still don't know how to use this baby like everybody uses it.
I mean, in that time span, I'm thinking the 90s, I remember the first phone I had the bag with the cord, and you know, and...
Yeah.
Shut up, mate!
Everybody didn't have them.
No.
You had to have a couple dollars to have them.
Well, I mean, I sold some Girl Scout cookies and stuff like that. You know what I mean? You know, whatever.
For sure.
Wipes was hot, you know what I mean? But I was just thinking of the technology and all the advancements that you didn't have when you went away and you come out to. So, I mean, the adjustment, you know, I just sit back and just, yet again,
bro, salute. Bro, listen. I can't in front on that. I can't get no salute on that because I'm scared to death of computers.
Wow.
I'm scared to death. I'm scared to hit the wrong button. I'm scared to erase something. I'm scared to death of computers. I was trying to get on today.
Uh-huh.
I was trying to get on a date, and I'm trying to figure out how to get into the Facebook thing and all of this stuff. I can't do it. I'm getting frustrated. I will call somebody in a minute. Hey, can you come over here, please, and do this? Or I'll bring my laptop to you. Like, I don't want to touch it. I got into barbering because I said, I don't want to be in the streets no more, right? But I like hustling. I like the hustle, right? But I like being my own boss also, right? So I said, what can I do as a profession that will give me the same feel and hustle of the streets without sending me back to prison? I said, a haircut. I said, I sit in the dope house, I can sit in the barbershop. I said, I sold some crack, I sell a haircut. They gave my money right then, I get my money right then, right? And ain't nobody gonna never let no computer cut their hair, right? This is what I say to myself. Fast forward, I get out, I'm working with Keelan, and everything is computer. I said, man, what is this? I'm like, what is this? I ain't touching nothing. I ain't hitting no button.
I mean, it being going through that, coming out on your end with your testimony is impressive. I'm like, man, he didn't see. Last he remembers stopping when we got a car full of quarters because you got to stop at that payphone. That's pretty much it. The code on there. Oh, that's such and such. That's that code. I gave her that code.
Other than that,
golly.
And it makes it so lazy because immediately, I'm talking about before I got out of prison, I memorized every phone number in my call log.
Yeah, now you can't even remember. I can't remember nobody's phone number now.
I barely know my phone number.
All right, I want to talk about, I was asking about like dating, being incarcerated all that time, because there's a saying that, you know, well, anyway, if you're there for so long, they'd be like, oh, okay, well, I ain't gay. I'm a product of my environment.
Or they gay for the state.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
So with that, and I do know where there are some officers, female officers as dating inmates, that happens all the time. They losing their job for the cat, they get out, and then they done broke up. What? You done lost your job and y'all ain't even together no more? Yeah. And y'all talked about the whole pen pal thing. What, like, how does that work with the pen pal? Is it like some type of program that you can get into a pen pal program?
No. I mean,
Your cellmate, like, hey, I know this girl don't want to holler, like.
So that's where most of it comes from.
Okay.
Right? That's where most of it comes from. But, you know, back when I first got locked up, they had different, like, ads and stuff like that. It wasn't a lot, but, you know, they had different ads and stuff that you was able to get to where you could put an ad in the paper or something like that. Then it started evolving. The pen pal industry started evolving. So they started making it easier for us to get to because it wasn't social media at the time. But it basically was like a lot of ads. Then it started being, when we started getting these different devices, being able to look up different stuff. Or you got your family on the streets, they telling you, hey, go write penpal.whatever, and they'll send you some information. Then you have people coming in, they like, well, here's a pen pal site that you can go on. And so it was a lot of different ways. And then you had the relationship with?
Whoever you had a relationship with, right. We already know how that goes down. Because, you know, with the shakedown. We know how that goes with the shakedown.
This is so crazy, right? And I usually don't address it because when a dude do a lot of times, especially if people don't necessarily care for you, that's usually when it happens. or they jealous of you. But a lot of times, they do a lot of time, one of the first things they say when he come home was, he got to be gay, right? And I heard that stuff coming out the door, you know what I'm saying? Either I'm gay or I'm screwing half the city. It wasn't no in between it.
Well, I'm one of the people to be like, they screwing half the city because you got all that pent up.
Please give me that.
Okay.
The funniest thing is, I had a female CO at almost every institution that I was in. So I wasn't having sex on a regular, like, you know, 3-4 times a week. But for me being in prison, you know,
you was cool.
I dressed in my knees as I could with a female. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, you have. I had a conversation with a warden that was cutting his hair.
Mm-hmm.
And I say, y'all problem is twofold. One, y'all teach these sisters or these women, because they just sisters, y'all teach these women when they come to the academy, y'all train them to look at us as almost less than human. We're going to be slick. We're going to be manipulative. That y'all give them all these negative things that we're going to be, that they're going to encounter, and that's why they should stay away from us or keep their distance, right? I said, the problem is, or one of the problems is, they run across somebody like me. I got my shit together. Even though I'm in prison, I got my shit together. I'm running multiple programs. I'm actually making probably the most money out of anybody in the institution by being a staff worker, by actually having the job. Three, I'm in an environment where it's not a dorm environment or nothing like that. A lot of times, they're coming up. And they're coming up to the barbershop. But even in a dorm environment, here's the thing. Men and women are naturally made to be together. So, I ain't saying all women do it, but...
I got you.
I would venture that all women that work in that environment, even if they haven't messed with a guy, have found guys attractive.
Oh, yeah.
Said to themselves, if not for this circumstance, I'll get him. You see what I'm saying? Because that we are naturally attracted to each other. Y'all want to legislate the nature out of a person. I'm going to always be attracted to women. You can't put me around no women and think that I'm not going to be attracted to them. You can't put women around men and think they're not going to be attracted to them. It makes no sense, right? And then I hit him with this. In general, most relationships start where?
At the workplace.
So if a woman is spending 16 hours a day at work because she just started and she working overtime, she getting froze, she doing all this stuff, the likelihood of her starting to have conversations with guys.
Because you're right, because once it's not with the CO, you go to the next. Because that's why a lot of marriages have broken up because of that. The interesting thing, I had to tell every time I go in my mind, what I programmed myself to think was everybody was a serial killer. I did. I ain't lying. That was my thing. Everybody a serial killer, and I just be rolling down there, so my neck on the swivel at all times, yeah. Head on, yeah, swivel, like boom, and that was it. Everybody a serial killer. Was there some nice people? Absolutely. In my mind, in the back, he nice, but he a serial killer, girl. You know. So that was there.
It helped you a little bit too because you was a nurse.
Uh huh.
So
I wasn't around all the time.
You know what I'm saying? But when you were a CO and you sitting in there, and you got COs that don't even like each other that got to work together, uh-huh, right? Then for a long time, it was one CO per dorm. I used to tell the sister all the time because she would come in and she had this, I'm just going to put my foot on y'all neck. I'm going to make y'all. I used to tell her all the time. I said, listen to me. I said, you don't have to come in and screw us. But if you come in acting like a woman, right, you're going to get way more
respect
than you is trying to put your foot on our neck. And I said another thing. You being a woman, just being a woman, being in your femininity, being a woman, you could be stern, you could be consistent, all that stuff, but just being a woman, being compassionate, being all of those things, when something happened and they jam that door shut where your support can't get to you, it's going to be us.
That's going to protect you.
Somebody from doing something to,
yep,
you. Don't forget that. You know what I'm saying? You ain't got to come in and act like no man, because if something happens, we're going to say you act like a man, handle it yourself. So, yeah.
Okay. Now, how does one get married being incarcerated for all those years? Sips tea.
I mean, you know, you know, nowadays.
Is that the pen did all that?
It's definitely. Well, yeah, for the most part, it's the pen. You have different, depending on the institution you at, you know, and the position you in that institution, you might be able to wiggle a little bit. So once they come for an event or something like that, you might be able to duck off, you know. We get real ingenuity under those circumstances, right? As long as you got somebody that's down, she got to be down.
Well, yeah, because this one officer was down. She had Velcro. Listen, I said, who the fuck?
Yeah.
The Velcro. I'm going to get you the Velcro. And then the one, bless her heart, she done swabbed the dude. And then, you know, shaking it down, boom, he got, you sit at the table, you know, the day room. And she in there bobbing for apples with him. And then he was like, well, I'm going to tell. And they say, you know, she bobbing the whole pot.
Yeah. That's why females, now they get smarter. If they mess with a dude, it's usually the dude who command a lot of respect. That they know ain't nobody going to cross this dude like that.
Okay.
Because you have that, you have that, where dudes try to manipulate, you know, situations, but, yeah. So, Nate.
What up, Pimp Juice? since we're on the prison reform, did you hear about Cali out in California?
No, what happened in Cali?
That if you're going to jail and you identify as a woman, they put you in a woman prison?
I ain't surprised.
Oh, yeah, but I mean, they got a whole bunch of female prisoners out there pregnant because...
Pregnant, right.
I identify as a woman, I'm telling you that.
Right.
I identify as a woman.
Right.
Now, you know what? I have to speak to that because we have had some that did say that and we would keep them in the infirmary. But you only got so many rooms. You only had 11 cells. So it's like, what are you going to do now? Which is interesting, but here's the thing. If you did not have the actual surgery, you can't go to the female pod.
I was shocked. I heard this not
too now. Long. Now they are, like Nate was saying, now they are. And I know because it was, matter of fact, don't quote me on this, but I'm almost certain that some females then got pregnant in the female prison by the female that they sent to the prison, right? Like, come on, man. What are we doing here, man? Like,
So are you telling? Because I want to talk about the topic. We saying something in 2024?
Inside or outside? Are you saying inside or outside?
Inside.
No.
Okay. Outside.
Listen.
Go ahead.
I gotta stick by the code that I was taught, right?
Okay.
Even if I see it, I ain't see it.
I ain't seen nothing.
Even if I seen it, I ain't seen it. You know what I'm saying? So I done had a few. I can't say I done had a few women since I've been home ask me about other people and how they got down. I'm like, man, I don't know.
Now isn't that strange? For real, isn't that strange though? Why would you ask? Yo, dude, how somebody else get down inside? Like,
no, they wasn't messing with me. They were interested in other individuals.
Oh, okay. So they want to know.
Yeah. So they want to ask me why hers. I don't know.
So that ain't none of your business.
Just leave me out. If I was interested in so and so, and I because I ain't trying to be no down low brother. Now, come on, you just gonna leave me hanging like that?
Listen,
you just leaving the ladies hanging like that?
You got to be somebody that's close to me for me to you know. But outside of that, I don't know.
I ain't saying that. I don't know.
You know what I'm saying? Because here's what I learned in prison. That most people we'd be a better off society if most people adopted this, believe it or not. Believe none of what you hear or half of what you see. Right? Believe none of what you hear or half of what you see. Because... there's dudes that's professional at lying, and there's dudes that's professional at painting a picture that's not accurate or true. So,
anyway.
so knowing that, it's like, you know, you gotta experience that for yourself, because I don't know for sure. I ain't been in no room with him. I don't know, so I ain't about to speculate.
So just take your chances.
I mean, you doing that? Hold on. Because it ain't just prison that's going on.
Right.
So you gotta do your vetting. You know what I'm saying? How you do your spending time with a dude, doing all those things. But because that ain't just going on in prison. That ain't just going on in prison.
True.
So, you know.
You ain't telling.
I try to stay away from that.
See something, say something. In 2024, and you said no.
Get me the out, dude.
You ain't got. I ain't telling you to out nobody. All I'm saying is we do be doing our homework. We do our, like, boom, you could look on the computer. Let me see. MA search. I'm looking at. If I see DV, deuces. If I see murder, I know how I could get reckless. I ain't trying to get killed. My mouth get reckless sometime. I ain't trying to do that, but like. Drugs, you be like, do I feel like putting myself in this situation? Because he going to be watched for the rest of his life, real talk. You know, so, it's like, you got a whole lot to take, you know, take into consideration.
But I got to say this.
Though. Go ahead, talk.
I got to say this. I got to stand up for the homies, right? It's a lot of good brothers that's in the penitentiary, man, that just made a mistake. It's a lot of good brothers, man, that just made a mistake, man, that's really good brothers. So, you... Shoot, somebody can say that about me. You know what I'm saying? I've been saying I was innocent since the day I walked through the door, but everybody's saying they're innocent. So somebody was saying about that. And you know what I'm saying? Somebody, he locked up for what? Yeah, no, I'm cool. You know what I'm saying? I heard such and such. I lost a girlfriend early on in my incarceration because somebody told her that I was gay. You know what I'm saying? Like, so it's a lot of good. There's a lot of good dudes that's behind them bars. They just made a mistake. And when they get their opportunity to come home, they're gonna be an asset to the community. I've been around them a long time. Dudes can only fake so long. When you do decades with guys, you know, because you see everything. You know, everybody. It was not one person. No, it was only one person. And she was just, I really think she was just jealous that I wouldn't have relations with her, and she knew I was having relations with another staff member. But it was one person. She was the only person who ever told me, "You gonna come back when you leave." Everybody else knew I wasn't coming back. It's guys who I actually seen when they got out, hook up with some chicks, and then the chicks come back to me like, "I can't believe." I said, "I can because I seen him every day. I seen him every day, so I'm not surprised that he did what he did."
Now, when you say come back, what that mean? Like, in a relationship, you're not returning? When you say, when you leave?
Like, yeah, you ain't going back to the penitentiary.
Oh, okay, I got you. Okay, now I get you. Okay. I thought you were talking about, I was stuck still on that. The book is Ready Rock Boy by Shimmie Miller. Make sure you guys get that.
Pre-sale. Get that.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm telling people, it's going to take you through every emotion, right?
Okay.
This is my life. Some of it you're going to be like, man, this nigga lying. I ain't lying.
You just said don't believe a half of what we hear and half of what we see or whatever you said.
That's why I put names in mind, because I don't got nobody co-signing what I say. I don't got nobody fact-checking. I don't got no problem with nobody fact-checking my stuff. But, yeah, it's ultimately, though, I really wrote it to try to give something to the homies, to the young people, based off of my experiences, and that's what I hope come out of it.
Okay. I hope so, too. I think they will. You still didn't answer me. How does one get married, you know, with all those years?
Believe it or not, that's all on the women. That's all on the women. The only thing a man does is send the paperwork. She got to go fill it out. She got to take it to the courthouse. She got to buy the rings. She got to do all of that. So... it's all on, and they do it like that on purpose, because they looking at it like, you're about to bury somebody in the penitentiary.
Yeah, that's me. That's me at the house like, girl, what? And then when he see everybody else, he gonna leave. Like, what the what? He gonna see us more to it.
Let her have her fantasy. Quit messing it up for her.
Right.
She believed that the 18 bodies that they found in this house wasn't his. She believed that. leave her alone.
Yeah.
Now, I just had a call. Hey, man, you got any book signings set up? You know, where I put my copies.
Yes, sir. So I'm having a major book release on my birthday, right? So I'm having a book release birthday party. It's a book release birthday bash, right? And I'm going to have book signing. People can actually go on my website, pre-order their book. Pre-order. That's what, bro?
Website, come on, man. No, go ahead.
Hey, listen, I'm trying to be all the way official up in this
thing. Right.
I even put on a button-up shirt for y'all today, man. Yeah, you can go on the website. You can pre-order it. The book, if you pre-order the book, that's going to count towards your ticket for the event. The ticket at the event is going to be a little higher, but it's going to be nice. It's going to be nice. Real nice.
Okay, so if you don't live here, because we know we're worldwide.
Yes.
Being in the Youngstown area, to yes. pre-order the book, you can get it. Okay, get it right, honey. Will, it's www, but now we could just pop it in. WillRespectFoundation.org to go ahead and get your book titled Ready Rock Boy by Shimmie Miller.
Yeah.
So you guys, check that out. Got to. I love Respect, your organization.
Thank you. I appreciate your support. I definitely appreciate it.
Don't give up.
If male support you, that's saying something, man. You hear me?
You ain't lying.
That's saying something. The reason is because it ain't what most people think. The reason is because when you get to it, I'm learning this. When you get to a certain level, you have to be extremely selective in the thing that you attach your name to. Right? So the fact that she has helped me and supported me on so many, people don't even know, bro. Like, just behind the scenes advice and all that stuff. It just, yeah, I appreciate it. So that means she liked what I'm doing. So I definitely appreciate that. For sure.
What? Hey, don't let her know she's kind of a big deal. I don't want to get that.
Got you.
So crazy. Okay. Let me put this up here. Ready Rock Boy by Shimmie Miller. And please, to order your book, pre-order it. It is WillRespectFoundation.org. So just go ahead and go to that website and you will actually order your book. Now, let's put it out there. Dates have not been set up yet where he will be doing book signings at, local libraries. So just kind of check that out. Stay tuned. Keep up on him. You can come to my website. Wait a minute. Wait, let me finish. You can come to my website or Shop Talk with Mel. Email shoptalkwithmel@yahoo.com. I'll give you that information. If you want to reach out to Shimmie Miller, I'll give you his information as well. If you would like him on your show, you can definitely do so. Contact me and I'll give you that information. Or you can go to the website, willrespectfoundation.org, to pre-order and just, you can obtain all the information that he has there. Shimmie, I want to say thank you for coming on and giving us some of your life without telling the whole book.
Yeah, you feel me?
I do.
It's going to be worth the purchase, though.
Absolutely. How much is the book?
The book, $23.
$23. Okay.
$23.
You know how many pages?
I figure I'm worth $23.
You worth $23?
Worth $23.
Okay, because you know some of the ladies out there, they get 40.
Yeah. They might expect too much for 40. They might expect you a little too much
for you for 40.
You know what I'm saying?
So thank you so much for coming on. Appreciate you.
And you having me.
Not a problem. We got to do it again.
For sure.
All right, let me do this one more time. Get you, get all your information up there.
Now, you know I don't know how to log out, so.
You good. I got you, my brother. Thanks for coming on. What, you was like, oh, wait. I'm here by myself. Hold on. Let's give it up for Shimmie Miller.
Hey, y'all silly.
All right, all right. There we go. I had to give it up. A great interview, great book. The book is really good. I didn't know what to expect from the book. And I was wondering even just with the title, because if you know me, you know, I'm like, okay, well, Ready Rock. I remember the whole scene. I remember what happened. So many people getting killed. Like, ugh, it's just stuck in my head. And a lot of people were remembering, like me, when they came on the scene where they had the 9/8s with the big tires, all that other stuff. They came through. It was like, oh, wait, there they go. And then you knew who the people were. And it's crazy because it was their name was prefaced with Ready Rock. So you had like Ready Rock Shimmie, Ready Rock Darnell. I'll definitely say him because he was on the show as well. Got to have him back. And he got pardoned by President Obama when he came on. So it's like looking at what you know, what you did, how you have grown and moving forward. I do love the fact that Shimmie was talking about, you know, how 26 years, you got to cut some slack and give them a break, because while we were just living life, and even you, Nate, how long did you do? 10 months?
I say 9.
Okay.
But it was months. Just say the number 9.
Number 9. Okay. So just having that experience, and I'm using that, you know, I say that loosely, experience, is something. Experience. And it's sad because I remember a few years back, I did the stats, Nick, I know you remember, when it was 70% of U.S. citizens will be convicted felons.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's a plan.
Listen, I mean, but this was some years back. This was, what was it about, like 10 years ago? 8 to 10 years ago. It was crazy. And the thing is, look at where we are and how it evolved. And where you have, you know, the old president, you know, up here about to be a convicted felon and still can be the president. And a lot of people are voting for him. Why? Because they can relate. Is that what's happening? And he said, growing up, you know, it makes you to be a man. But do we have to get incarcerated to be a man? How come the men just can't step up?
Because there's no institution on the outside.
It's just, does it really need to be?
You need something behind it. You need a solid foundation.
Okay.
It's sad. Prison is a sort of a foundation, because the old heads in there will learn respect, and you will. And that's why I was saying with him, it's sad to say, I see boys growing up to be men that have to go through that for whatever type of time. When they come out, you know, they're either better or worse.
Okay.
But it's on them. But while you're in there, there's certain things that you can't do. It ain't about how you feel. It's the way of the land.
Oh, you can't express how you feel in there.
No. You know what? I'm feeling kind of parched today. I don't want to wash the socks or do whatever I have to do. No. We don't want to hear that. There's repercussions.
Okay.
It's not a place where you just feel a certain way and people care about that. No. The whole thing about it is respect. It ain't feelings. And what do men want? Respect.
Men want respect.
Yes.
And women want respect as well. Watch this. Men want respect and women want to feel respected.
Yeah, because you know it's all about your feelings.
Yeah, Nate the Agitator. Feelings. Yes, I've been saying that from day one. Say that from day one. The man who did the first human to animal kidney transplant, the pig.
Oh.
Rick. Yeah. Mr. Ricky done passed away. Yes, Richard Rick Slayman, 62 years old. He was suffering from kidney disease, end-stage kidney disease, and he decided to go ahead and have that pig, you know, the pig kidney transplant, to see how it worked. Because we already know, like, the pig, it helped, it do some things. But he passed away. Now, what they were saying is that the pig is not what killed him. He was at end stage. So he ended up passing away 2 months later. Now, they said that pork could kill you. Y'all better be careful out there.
I mean, the hardest, well, I'm not no medical dude, but I've read a book or heard a story.
Okay.
The hardest thing to transplant in a human is the esophagus, and that's what they use from pigs. And I heard that that's like really popular. They can change your esophagus with pig esophagus.
They do a lot. Go ahead. What you got, Nick?
My mother in 1979 had her first open heart surgery. And the very first one, she had a pig valve. And
did she?
Yeah. She didn't have to have another one, another open heart surgery until 95. And then she had a mechanical valve at that time because it would be real quiet. And then all of a sudden you could hear it. And I'd be like, Mom, you're ticking again. And she, you better be glad you can hear me ticking because when you stop.
You can hear it?
Yeah.
Wow. We're going to do that for the male's medical moment.
Quiet. You can hear it. But yeah, the very first open heart surgery, they replaced my mom's valve with a pig valve.
Well, they said that pork could kill you. Yet the people that say they don't eat pork, they be tearing up that jello. You know that gelatin mold, the marshmallows, tearing that up like this is good, yum yum. The gummy bears, yum yum. I mean, you got a whole lot. The Cheetos, the hot Cheetos, yum yum. Like what you Colgate, yum yum. Like what you gonna do? But that insulin saving lives now. And they do have some that's not, you know, made from the pig, but that insulin saving lives. So you said your mom had a pig valve put in.
Very first one, the mitral valve, they
wow,
I think that's when they were first experimenting with it, and so
and she took a shot. Go ahead, girl. Now that's what's up. So I want to know, you know, with the topic, we know inside, don't you see something, you don't say nothing in 2024. Should we become Karens or not? If you saw the situation with Diddy, would you say something or no?
Yep, no. I'm telling.
I'm not.
You're not? Okay, explain.
Because it's domestic.
Okay.
They'll turn on me. They'll turn, like, you know, if it was random, I would be more inclined to tell if it was a random accident.
Uh-huh.
Your boyfriend or your husband or stuff like that, no. No, because then I'm the liar and then this, that, and other because he didn't.
They're going to end up going back to the person.
Right. Then,
how would you feel later on if that person died and you could have saved their life by telling them?
Mm-hmm. Hey, if I saved their life and he went to jail and they mad at me, then they coming at me. If I'm not in that, I'm not in that. Now, if she's in a position where she died, I'll send some roses. But I'm like, oh, man. Well, hey, if she like it, I love it. I'm new, not with domestic, especially, no. Please.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd have been in a couple of them situations. I ain't tell, but I got into it with a couple of dudes. And, you know, that's my.
And you're not doing it.
You ain't gonna put your hands on my sister, then they end up back with the person, and then.
And that happens. Now I called the police on my neighbor one time because he was beating her up. She hollering, help me, help me. And I feel the same as like Nick, like, wait a minute, what if something happened to her? So I called the police. So when I called the police went over there to the house. I saw them when they came over there. So we're side by side. Okay. And it's just her and I. And the police officer walked right across the grass, child. Didn't even come up the sidewalk, went across the grass, knocked on my door and was like, he said he wasn't beating her. He said it wasn't fighting. Now the police came and said that, so then now they know I told. So now guess what? Now I got to be hard. I was like, what? I was like, they was fighting. So I had to like lean out. And he was like, no, Miss Mel. I said, come on now. And so the police officer left. Now this guy, he was a dope boy. So officer, you put me in harm's way. I'm trying to help somebody. You put me in harm's way. So I get it. And what he told me, the young man said to me, he was like, I told her to call the police. I said, okay, well, here's the thing. I said, y'all get into it, at least give her the phone so she can call the police. He said, you got a deal. And then I was out. But I just couldn't sit there and not say something, even though the situation could have been a lot different. It could have been a lot different because the people that's supposed to protect and serve that sat there, walked across the grass. I'm like, can I help you? And tell me something. They said, and they looking at me out the window. He looking at me. He was like, they said they wasn't fighting. I said, what? After I seen him out there, I was like, come on. But I had to like man up, air quotes. You know, like, come on. What are we doing? And that, I think that is why people aren't saying anything anymore. Because they're being involved and you're going to put them in harm's way. Just like all the murders. They was like, if y'all see something, say something. Why? So you could tell? Because we're not trusting anybody.
No good deed goes unpunished. That's in the Bible.
Dang, I can't even reply to that.
Hey, no good deed goes unpunished.
All right, so Nick, what you got? If you see something, you saying something these days?
It depends. I ain't even gonna lie, it depends. It depends who it is and what the situation is.
Okay. And Nate, you said no?
Hey, whatever floats your boat, you might be in there getting punched in that left eye.
Okay, now watch this. Now, people that know me, they knew a long time ago. I remember, like, even when people was about to smoke weed, somebody was about to ask. My friend was like, mm-mm. They already know. Don't do nothing around Mel because she telling. I'm telling you right now. If you're around me and you plan on doing something off, I'm telling. And I'm telling you, I'm telling. So don't do nothing around me. Real talk. I wanted to talk about what's happening these days. We talked about the man. He tried to do his thing. His family is okay, 62 years old. Done passed away like that. That's crazy. All the people in their business or who they sleeping with, y'all invested in that?
No.
Exactly. R. Kelly, they said R. Kelly is the one that told on P. Diddy.
I heard.
Allegedly. Go ahead. What you hear?
Allegedly. I heard that they were saying that R. Kelly was supposed to be one of the allegedly Illuminati sacrifices.
I did see that, but you know, that type of stuff, I just be like, yeah, it's over my head because I ain't really invested in these folks. They don't know me.
That's why him mm-hmm. and Jay-Z allegedly got into when they did that first album and, you know, certain
Best
things.
Wait, what'd you say? That didn't go nowhere, though, did it?
That was because of the leak.
Aaliyah. Yeah, they all wanted the girl.
Yeah. And he still ended up sacrificed, though. Allegedly.
No, he is sacrificed. That's 30 years later.
Yeah.
30 years later, so.
And all this stuff happening with Diddy is years and years.
Now, what's interesting, you know what? All of Hollywood, it's coming out. Hollywood is just coming out. Because even with a lot of the Disney stars, they're coming out saying all the issues that they're occurring. Orlando Brown, he's been saying the whole thing. He said, I'll take the crazy road, but I'm going to still talk.
Yeah.
So, and that kind of has me worried, and it has a few people around me worried.
Regarding what?
Where my career is going, the Hollywood thing. It's like, do I even want to get into that now?
Because Well, Atlanta is like the new, it's not Hollywood anymore. People are going to Atlanta now.
But
they soon will be coming to Houston because 56. Has been in, you know,
doing his thing,
trying to bring the studio.
But it might be something totally different. And speaking of Houston, how you doing down there? You didn't get hit by a hurricane?
Not where I'm at, but there is a lot of areas further north in Houston.
Well, I'm glad that. I see your fireplace still up back there.
Everything
looks good.
Kind of bad. There were several people that died the other day. So just wanted to prayers out to their family and everything. So yeah. Nick was doing, in fact, Nick was in here plugging away for school, so I'm good. It got ugly, but I'm good.
Wow. What about I've gotta ask this question. If your mom does not like your mate, do you end it with your mate?
Yes.
Okay. What's your thoughts, Nick?
Huh?
Huh? I ain't stutter.
What happened was I didn't listen and still got a wedding paid for, and then later on that was the first one. But
The reason I'm bringing that up is because Love is Blind contestant ended up dating a female that had her only fans page, and his mom came on and said you could do better, and I don't know how long that relationship is gonna last. And I noticed, like, with black men, they tend to care what their mom thinks. And that's like the deciding factor. Where with black women, you just go with it. Like, what's happening?
Well, I can, you know, I go deep on my thoughts.
Go ahead.
black man, you have to remind me something of my mother. That was the first woman I loved.
Okay.
If a black woman doesn't have a father to say, hey, that's the first person I love, she'll just, it's not as ingrained.
Mm-hmm.
It's not as ingrained in a woman to man as it is a man and a woman. So me being a man, if my mom had a problem with a girl, I'm like, oh, I trust her judgment. And there's something about the woman that I choose that reminds me of my mom. So I believe that a man will listen to his mother over, well, girls usually listen to their dads if their dad is in their life.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, yeah.
So now, it is safe to say that men date women who has something that reminds them of their mother.
Mm-hmm. A trait. Or remind them. Yeah, yeah.
I always felt that though.
That's familiar. You're familiar. You know, when I was breastfeeding, you know, my mom, that's why I'm a boob dude. I mean, baby.
That's interesting though. That's an interesting point. It's an interesting point because I know that usually when there's like as a female, see, it's a little different because as a female, I'm attracted to people who have stability. I'm attracted to men. They just happen to have both parents in the household, all of them.
But that's your thing. I mean,
I don't know though. So it's a trait in them, and then you find out like once you go, oh, here we go. Now I've never dated anybody that I didn't meet their mother.
Right. When dating, I always want to know, who do I remind you of? What man in your life do I remind you of? Is it your uncle, your father, your grandfather?
Okay.
And I mean, if I was father or grandfather, I'm like, okay, you will understand me. Uncle, yeah, okay, cool. But if you don't remind me of nobody in my family, I'm like, oh boy. So everything I do to you is foreign. Or you haven't seen it
before. That makes sense because they all know how to fix stuff.
Right.
Well, they all, and a lot of women are. A lot of women are, some are like, how much you make, you know, I want money, I want this and that. Where I am, if you could save me money, we good. Because if this runs out, I still need you to be able to fix it.
Most of those women that are money-based don't have a strong male figure in their life. And I'm just shooting from the book of Nate, so I could be wrong.
I got you.
I see, and I... Yeah.
What about that? Did you see that they interviewed the young girls and they were like, well, do you want a man, if you got pregnant and a man said, pay so much money, do you want the money or him and his life?
Right.
And they were like, give me the money, run me my check. That was sad. It was so sad because it's a younger generation. Let me give you today's footnote. Today's footnote is, tell me and I forget, teach me and I remember. Involve me and I'll learn. Author unknown. All right, lovely people, that is my time. I thoroughly enjoyed you as I do each and every single Saturday. Listen, today's topic was see something, say something in 2024. Are you telling or no? Nate Shimmie said no. Find you, embrace you, most importantly, always, always love you. Until next week, people. 1, 2, 3. Shut up.
Shut up.
Ah!